Worship this morning according to the common service on page 15 in the front of the hymnal. In the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Beloved in the Lord, let us draw near with a true heart and confess our sins to God our Father, asking him in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ to grant us forgiveness. Holy and merciful Father, I confess that I am by nature sinful and that I have disobeyed you in my thoughts, words, and actions. I have done what is evil and failed to do what is good. For this I deserve your punishment, both now and in eternity. But I am truly sorry for my sins, and trusting in my Savior, Jesus Christ, I pray, Lord, have mercy on me, a sinner. God, our Heavenly Father, has been merciful to us and has given his only Son to be the atoning sacrifice for our sins. Therefore, as a called servant of Christ and by his authority, I forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
In the peace of forgiveness, let us praise the Lord. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Mercifully grant, O God, that your Holy Spirit may in all things direct and rule our hearts. For without your help, we are unable to please you. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Our Old Testament lesson for today is from Ezekiel chapter 37, beginning at verse 1. The hand of the Lord was upon me, and he brought me out by the Spirit of the Lord and set me in the middle of a valley. It was full of bones. He led me back and forth among them, and I saw a great many bones on the floor of the valley, bones that were very dry. He asked me, "Son of man, can these bones live?" I said, "O sovereign Lord, you alone know." And he said to me, "Prophesy to these bones and say to them, 'Dry bones, hear the word of the Lord. This is what the sovereign Lord says to these bones. I will make breath enter you, and you will come to life. I will attach tendons to you and make flesh come upon you and cover you with skin. I will put breath in you and you will come to life. And you will know that I am the Lord.'" So far, the Old Testament lesson. Our psalm of the day, these words of Psalm 51. "Surely I was sinful at birth, sinful from the time my mother conceived me. Surely you desire truth in the inner parts. You teach me wisdom in the inmost place." So far, the psalm of the day. And our epistle lesson in our continuing study of Paul's letter to the Ephesians from chapter 2, beginning at verse 1. "As for you, you were dead in your transgressions and sins, which you used to live, and you followed the ways of this world and of the ruler of the kingdom of the air, the spirit who is now at work in those who are disobedient. All of us also lived among them at one time, gratifying the cravings of our sinful nature, following its desires and thoughts. Like the rest, we were by nature objects of wrath. But because of his great love for us, God, who is rich in mercy, made us alive with Christ, even when we were dead in transgressions. It is by grace you have been saved. And God raised us up with Christ and seated us with him in the heavenly realms in Christ Jesus, in order that in the coming ages he might show the incomparable riches of his grace expressed in his kindness to us in Christ Jesus. For it is by grace you have been saved, through faith. And this, not from yourselves, it is the gift of God, not by works, so that no one can boast. For we are God's workmanship, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do." This is the word of the Lord. Alleluia. Blessed are those who hear the word of God and obey it. Alleluia. Holy Gospel is written in the 5th chapter according to St. John, beginning at the 24th verse. Glory be to you, Lord. I tell you the truth, whoever hears my word and believes him who sent me has eternal life and will not be condemned. He has crossed over from death to life. I tell you the truth, the time is coming and has now come. And the dead will hear the voice of the Son of God, and those who hear will live. For as the Father has life in himself, so he has granted the Son to have life in himself, and he has given him authority to judge because he is the Son of Man. Do not be amazed at this, for a time is coming when all who are in their graves will hear his voice and come out. Those who have done good will rise to live, and those who have done evil will rise to be condemned. This is the Gospel of the Lord. Let us join in confessing our faith according to the words of the Apostles' Creed, as printed on page 19 in the front of the hymnal. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you all. Amen. Our text in our continuing study of Paul's letter to the Ephesians, chapter 2. God, who is rich in mercy, made us alive with Christ, even when we were dead in transgression. In our Old Testament lesson this morning, the prophet Ezekiel shows us a fascinating vision. The people of Judah, to whom the promise of the Savior was given, are carried away into captivity. They say to themselves, stick a fork in us, we're done. Our hope as a nation, gone, dead. And our hope of a coming salvation is dead too. It's all over. Then the Lord gives to the prophet a vision of hope. He shows the prophet Ezekiel a valley. The floor of the valley is littered with dry bones, the scattered, bleached bones of men long dead. And the Lord says to the prophet, son of man, can these bones live? In other words, hey, what do you think? These guys gonna get up and walk around again? Fearful, of course, of underestimating the God of impossible cases, the prophet humbly replies, well, Lord, you alone know. So the Lord commands the prophets to speak. Speak the word of God over the dry, bleached, scattered bones. And suddenly there is a rumbling and a shaking and a rattling, and all the bones are flying back and forth across the valley, coming together again. And suddenly the valley is covered with fully assembled skeletons. And then as the prophet watches, tendons, flesh begin to blanket the bones. And now the valley is filled with bodies, but lifeless. And then, as God once in the beginning breathed the breath of life into Adam, so the breath of God, the Spirit of God, enters the bodies. They stand up on their feet, a vast army. That's the vision. Now, when we read that vision in Ezekiel, we might be inclined to relate it to the resurrection of all flesh on the last day, which will, of course, certainly occur. But the Lord tells Ezekiel that this is something that happens long before Judgment Day. Son of man, these bones are the whole house of Israel. I will put my spirit in them and they will live. The people of Judah thought their hope was dried up, their hope of a salvation and a savior all gone and dead. And yet God raised them back to life, brought them back from their captivity, settled them in their own land, and revived in them again a life of hope instead of hopelessness, made them alive again. What God told the prophet Ezekiel is what St. Paul tells us in the opening lines of Ephesians chapter 2. That we were dead, without hope, without a relationship with God. But God, through the gospel, word, sacrament, raised us to life again. It's about being dead or alive. Paul says, as for you, you were dead in your transgressions and sins in which you used to live when you followed the ways of this world and the ruler of the kingdom of the air, the spirit who is now at work in those who are disobedient. All of us also lived among them at one time, gratifying the cravings of our sinful nature and following its desires and thoughts. Like the rest, we were by nature objects of wrath. Now, when Paul says to the Ephesians, when he says to you and me, you were dead, you and I might think, well, that's just kind of an exaggerated figure of speech, kind of a hyperbole. He doesn't really, no, he means it. We were dead. Apart from Christ, apart from our relationship with Christ, as we are by birth and nature, we are dead in transgressions and sins. It goes back to what God said to Adam and Eve in the beginning regarding the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. You must not eat from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, for when you eat of it, you will surely die. And any Sunday school kid could tell you, now wait a minute, they didn't drop dead the moment they ate from the tree. They didn't die right away. Yes, they did. It's just that you and I tend to think of death wrongly. Even sometimes in the back of our own minds as Christians, we tend to think of death as some sort of non-existence, but that's not it. The Bible speaks of death as an existence, but it is an existence that is marked by separation. Physical death is a physical separation of the body and soul at the moment of our physical death. The book of Ecclesiastes in the Bible says that the dust returns to the ground it came from, the soul returns to God who gave it. Spiritual death, which Paul is talking about here, is the spiritual separation of a person from a relationship with God. You got no life with God. You've got no relationship with God. You've got no beating heart with God. And you're spiritually dead. Eternal death is the separation of body and soul for all eternity from this relationship and this life with God. The book of Revelation even calls it the second death. The Bible calls it hell. It's not non-existence. That's the nasty part of it. You do exist, but you exist for all eternity apart from God and His blessings. Now, when you gals see your husband on the couch snoring away in the living room, you might make the comment, he's dead to the world. And of course, what you mean by that is not that he's physically non-existent, but that he's insensitive, dead to anything going on around him. That's the way it is with people who are spiritually dead. They are absolutely insensitive to anything that is going on around them in regard to God. They've got no life with God. They are dead to God. And so the Bible says here, that's the way you used to live. When you followed the ways of this world and of the ruler of the kingdom of the air, the spirit who is now at work in those who are disobedient. You might say we lived according to the prevailing attitude of the times, the spirit of the times, the in thing. We used as our alibi in this ungodly life, as separated from life with God, that well, everybody else is doing it. And so we were simply ruled by this spirit or ruler of the kingdom of the air. They say, what in the world, kingdom of the air? Paul explains it with the words, the spirit who is now at work in the sons, or in those who are disobedient, literally the sons of the disobedient, spiritually, as we are by birth and nature. We are chips off the old block of a darker father, the devil. And his influence permeates the world and human nature the way air permeates everything. And says Paul, now at work in the sons of those who are disobedient, all of us lived among them at one time. He does not exclude himself. He does not exclude you or me. As we are conceived and born in sin, he says, all of us lived among them at one time, gratifying the cravings of our sinful nature, following its desires and thoughts. Like the rest, we were by nature objects of wrath. What this is talking about here is the Bible's massive assertion of a thing we call original or inherited sin. that we are born into this world as God's enemies, without true faith in God, without a life with God, opposed to God, not thinking the thoughts of God. It's the way we are by nature. Now, this may not seem a pleasant thing to hear. We may prefer the world's Kool-Aid that gets fed to us, that basically all people are noble and all people are basically good, and that any faults we have are basically a result of society, and by the way, society is made up of people, you know, and also some glitch perhaps in our genetics or whatever, but essentially we're all good people. But the Bible's explanation is still the best. How else do you explain, come to grips with our own wicked ways, our foul mouths, our ungodly behavior? How else do you explain the mass shootings, to say nothing of the rule of death over mankind, all the dark things that happen, if you do not understand this thing called original sin, why we are the way we are, without Christ, dead in transgressions and sins? It's kind of like this kid who was watching his dad chop the heads of chickens off. And as they ran around the barnyard, he said, "Look, Daddy, they're dead and they don't know it." Or you think of, well, if you're a little older, Night of the Living Dead, right? Spiritual zombies. Or a different generation, that movie The Sixth Sense, where the little kid Cole is talking to his shrink, Malcolm, and he says to the psychiatrist, "I see dead people." Malcolm, the psychiatrist, says, "You mean like in your dreams?" Shakes. "You mean like in graves and coffins?" He shakes his head. How often do you see them? All the time. Well, where? They're walking around like regular people. They don't see each other. They only see what they want to see. They don't know that they're dead. You see them how often? All the time. They're everywhere. That's right. There are dead people all the time, all around us, everywhere. Oh, active. Perhaps heavily involved in the world. Perhaps even having a jolly good time. But they're dead. No life. But God, in this dark room, beams in light. Because of his great love for us, God, who is rich in mercy, made us alive with Christ, even when we were dead in transgressions. It is by grace you have been saved. And God raised us up with Christ and seated us with him in the heavenly realms in Christ Jesus, in order that in the coming ages he might show the incomparable riches of his grace expressed in his kindness to us in Christ Jesus. Two words shine a beam of light into this dark room. Death. But God. But because of his great mercy for us, God, who is rich in mercy, made us alive even when we were dead in transgressions and sins. It is by grace you have been saved. Saved, as Israel was once saved when there was no possible way out. Trapped between the charging chariots of Pharaoh and the churning whitecaps of the Red Sea. But God made a way out, parting the waves, when there was no way out. But God. He raised us up with Christ. When Christ rose from the dead, we rose with him to a new life now, a new life hereafter. A life which we now have in Christ Jesus. in which our gospel lesson from John reminded us as Jesus spoke of two resurrections. The one of our sinful flesh, now we are raised to a spiritual life in Christ as believers. And our resurrection on the last day when all who hear his voice will come out of their graves. It is of this first type of coming to life that Jesus spoke when he said, "The hour, the time is coming and has now come. And those who hear the voice of the Son of God will live." You and I have heard the voice of the Son of God, and we now live as we've been brought to faith by the Holy Spirit through the gospel and the gospel waters of baptism and the preached word and in the body and blood of the Holy Sacrament. He brought us to life. He made us alive, and he seated us with him in the heavenly realms. Did you notice the past tense? Seated us. When God makes a promise, it is so sure and certain he can talk about it as though it's already done. He has seated us with him in the heavenly realms in Christ Jesus. And then to tie a bow on the package, Paul sums up our new life like this: "For it is by grace you have been saved through faith, and this not from yourselves, it is the gift of God, not by works, so that no one can boast. For we are God's workmanship, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do." Here in a Bible passage you doubtless have memorized since childhood is the heart of it all: by grace. Grace is God's undeserved love. You must not assume that when some people use certain words, they mean the same thing you mean. The word grace does not mean, as some have said, is kind of an ability that has been kind of poured into or infused into you, thereby enabling you to do good things to earn points with God. No, grace is a pure, free, undeserved gift. Grace is not just getting something for nothing. It's getting the very opposite of what we had coming. That's grace, and that's why we call it amazing grace. Through faith, we come to the personal enjoyment of what Christ did for all people on the cross when the Holy Spirit makes Christians out of us, when he raises us to life and brings us to faith so that we now believe this. This faith is not a decision on our part. Jesus said, "You did not choose me, I chose you." It is not something we did any more than Lazarus started to wiggle his toes and help Jesus out in raising him from the dead. It is totally of God. No man can say Jesus is Lord except by the Holy Spirit. Through faith. And this, even this faith, not of yourselves. It is the gift of God, not by works, so no one can boast. Now, what's the outcome of all this? We are God's workmanship, created in Christ Jesus to do good works. As God made the sun to shine, as he made apple trees to have apples, so he created you and me in Christ Jesus, created us to be Christians through the gospel. The word create is used in the Bible only of something God can do. We are God's workmanship, created in Christ Jesus to do good work. Where's work of art? You, I, all Christians are God's masterpiece. Now, who gets the credit for a work of art? The canvas? The brush? The paint? No. We even call works of art by the name of the artist, don't we? Oh, that's a Picasso. That's a Rembrandt. That's a Da Vinci. Who gets the credit for a novel or a poem, a work of literature? The pen? The ink? The paper? Shakespeare, Dickens, Hemingway. Who gets the credit that you and I are God's masterpieces, his works of art, people brought back to life again? God alone. Here you and I are, once again brought to life. To what end? To do good works which God has prepared in advance for us to do. It's Luther's old comment that you don't have to lecture your pear tree to have pears. It'll have pears. It's a pear tree. And water is wet, and Christians do good works, which God has prepared in advance for us to do. Every detail of your life as you live out your faith in Christ, from sharing the gospel to cleaning the garage, from reading your Bible to honoring your parents, from listening to the Word of God to mowing the lawn. Every little detail of your life, from loving your spouse to keeping house, all of it, God prepared it in advance for you to do. Your assignment, your opportunity to live out the real life with God that He made you to have. Isn't it great to be alive? Amen. Peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, shall keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. Amen. It hath pleased Almighty God to summon out of this vale of tears to our eternal home the soul of Elmer Horstman, who departed this life last Monday at the age of 96. Services were held here at the church yesterday. Let us pray. O Lord God, thou Lord of life and death, who turnest man to destruction and sayest, "Return, ye children of men," we give thee thanks for all the mercies which during his long life thou didst bestow upon this our beloved brother now fallen asleep. Especially do we thank thee for having brought him to the knowledge of thy dear Son, Jesus Christ. We pray thee comfort the survivors with thine everlasting comfort and cheer them with the sweet hope of a blessed reunion in heaven. Grant to the lifeless body rest in the bosom of the earth, and hereafter, together with us all, a joyful resurrection to life everlasting. Teach us all to number our days, that we may apply our hearts unto wisdom and finally be saved. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Let us also offer up a prayer of thanks on the occasion of the 50th wedding anniversary of Ray and Bonnie Horstman. We pray. Lord Jesus, your mercies are new every morning. We thank you for the grace by which you have sustained your servants throughout 50 years of their married life. We ask that you continue to fill their hearts with the unselfish love that reflects your sacrificial love for them, so that their love for each other may never grow weary. With every joy and sorrow that they share, bring them closer to each other and to you, their God and Lord. Encourage all husbands and wives as they seek to fulfill their marriage promises, and bless all our homes with your abiding peace. We ask it in your name, you who have taught us to pray, Our Father who art in heaven. Hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Let us pray. Almighty God, grant to your church the Holy Spirit and the wisdom that comes from above. Let nothing hinder your word from being freely proclaimed to the joy and edifying of Christ's holy people, so that we may serve you in steadfast faith and confess your name as long as we live, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look on you with favor and give you peace.
You're all invited downstairs for the fellowship hour. Please read.